Good morning to all the students of class 9. I am Dinesh Ranjan and today I am going to make another video from the book Moments, the fourth chapter in the Kingdom of Fools by A.K. Ramanujan. First of all, I will give you the brief introduction of the author. A.K. Ramanujan was born in 1929 and he died in 1990. He was poet, translator, folklorist, and he was born in Mysore, India. Folk tales from India is one of his works in translation. It is a collection of 110 tales taken from 22 different languages. It's a collection of folk tales. This story naturally comes from that book. Now the summary. The story is set in the Kingdom of Fools, where the king and his minister decided to turn night into day. They wanted to do things differently from other kingdoms. So, orders were passed, and out of fear of punishment, the subjects slept during the day and worked at night. Now, it so happened that a guru and his disciple entered the kingdom one day and were amazed to see this. Everything was so cheap there. Despite the guru's warning against idiots, the disciple insisted on staying back there. The guru left, but the disciple stayed. One day, a thief broke into a rich merchant's house and was crushed by a wall. His brother approached the king for justice, since he had died while pursuing his ancient trade. The blame game leads to twists and turns in the story. The disciple gets caught in this whole confusion and is about to be punished. The disciple remembered his guru's words and prayed to him. By his magical powers, the guru saw that his disciple was in trouble. He came over immediately. The guru begged the king to execute him first and then the disciple. The disciple understood his master's plan and asked to be killed first. The king wanted to know the mystery behind both asking for death. The guru told the king that the one to be executed first would return as the king of the kingdom, and the one executed second would be the future minister. The king and the minister instructed the executioners which prisoner was to be killed first and which one second. Then they released the guru and his disciple and took their place. The next day, they were executed. When everyone realized that the king and the minister had been killed, the people asked the guru and the disciple to rule the kingdom. The two agreed on the condition that they would change all the foolish laws. Now, the overall theme of the story is, this is a folk tale. And it is a kind of warning against greed. The disciple was greedy for food and did not listen to his guru's wise words to get away from a kingdom ruled by fools. He became fat because of his greed for food and was almost executed for a crime he did not commit. Now this folk tale also mocks people in power who do not rule with good sense. Intelligence is more important than a position of authority. The Guru saved his disciple by using his good sense. The king and his minister were foolish enough to believe what the Guru said. Their greed for power, even in the next life, caused them to die. Well, this was the brief summary. But when you go through the story in detail, some of the important points you will come across. Firstly, the two strange things the Guru and disciple are found in the kingdom of fools. Although it was broad daylight, there was no one about in the beautiful city. Everyone was asleep, including the cat. Not a mouse was stirring. The shops opened in the evening. And secondly, all groceries, no matter what or how much was bought, cost the same, a single duttu. Now the disciple took the decision to stay in this kingdom of food because he was very delighted, because they could buy the food they wanted for a rupee, and all he wanted was good cheap food. He wanted to stay because everything was very cheap. Well, it was not a good idea because it was a kingdom of fools. One could not tell how long the fools would last or what they would do next. In the story, many names come one by one. Well, I will tell you about the names which have come in the case of thief. The rich merchant was called because the wall had collapsed and killed the thief. Next to be called was the bricklayer who had built the wall. The bricklayer had been distracted by a dancing girl's anklets as she walked. The dancing girl accused the goldsmith of not giving her ornaments on time. The goldsmith had to complete a rich merchant's order first. The rich merchant was the father of the merchant whose wall it was. The merchant was called again as the heir to his dead father's punishment. But in this entire confusion, who was the real king, according to the king? The king feels that the owner of the house, the merchant, is the real culprit. His father had ordered the ornaments. The son must inherit the dead father's riches as well as his sins. Somebody had to be punished, and the king had known all along it was the merchant. The minister notices that the merchant is too thin to be properly executed on the estate. So he escapes punishment and the disciple has been brought to be killed. The king and the minister had brought several changes in the kingdom. They had changed the night into the day and day into night. Everyone should be awake at night, till their fields and run their businesses only after dark, and go to bed as soon as the sun comes up. People do as they are told for fear of death, even the cattle asleep in the day. It is the kingdom of fools, and both the king and the minister are idiots. They do not want to run things like other kings. Now, about the grocery. What was special about the grocery? To their great astonishment, the guru and the disciple find that everything costs the same, a single duddu. Duddu perhaps stands for 1 rupee or whatever. Whether they buy a measure of rice or a bunch of bananas, it costs a duddu. Very soon, after a short time, because the food was so cheap, the disciple turns into a fat man. He turns a fat like a street side sacred bull. He decides to stay back in the kingdom because of his fondness for food, cheap food, which is available in the kingdom. he becomes fat on a diet of ghee, rice, bananas, or wheat. So finally, this fatness leads him to trouble. When the merchant is about to be executed, the minister points out that the merchant is too thin to be killed proper at the stake. They need a fatter person. The soldiers search for a man fit enough for the stake and come across the disciple. He is considered suitable for execution and is arrested. About the thief, the thief breaks into a rich merchant's house. As he is carrying his loot out through the hole he has made in the wall to sneak in, the wall of the old house collapses on his head. He dies on the spot. Now the thief's brother, he makes a complaint to the king. He complains that when his brother was pursuing his ancient trade, a wall fell on him and killed him. He blames the merchant, the owner of the house. He should have built a good, a strong wall. The king should punish the wrongdoer and compensate the family for the justice, for this injustice. So according to the thief's brother, it was the merchant who was responsible. So far as bricklayer was concerned, how did he escape the punishment? The bricklayer pleads innocence. He says that when he built the wall, his mind was not on it. A dancing girl was going up and down that street all day with her anklets jingling. He couldn't keep his eyes or mind on the wall he was building. Therefore, the fault lay with the dancing girl. Now the dancing girl, she calls the goldsmith. She puts the blame upon goldsmith, and even she calls him a lazy scoundrel. Well, she says that she had given some gold to the goldsmith to make jewelry for. He was a lazy scoundrel. He made many excuses. He kept promising he would give her jewelry and then did not hand it over as promised. He made her walk up and down to his house a dozen times. So this way some of the details come in the story. The Guru's words of wisdom. Although everything is cheap in the kingdom, the Guru realizes that this is no place for them. He cautions his disciple, they are all fools. This won't last very long and you can't tell what they will do to you next. When the disciple refuses to listen, he tells him to do as he wishes and leaves. To punish the criminal who killed the thief and compensate for the injustice, the king summons the merchant, the bricklayer, the dancing girl, the goldsmith, and finally the merchant again. The minister thinks the merchant is too thin to be executed properly on the stake. The disciple who has become fat after eating to his fill is found to be suitable to fit the stake. He pleads that he is innocent and a sannyasi, but in vain. He remembers his guru's words when he is carted to the place of execution. When he remembered his guru, naturally, by his magical powers, the Guru saw and understood everything, and by his magical power, he appeared before his disciple and he saved the life of his disciple. The disciple prays to his Guru. The Guru sees a vision and knows the disciple is in trouble. He arrives at the city. He tells the king that the Guru is greater, hence the king should send him to the stake first. The disciple understands the plan and clamors to be killed first. The Guru flatters the king as the god of justice. He says, whoever dies on the new estate will be reborn as the king of the country, and the one who dies next as the minister. The Guru claims they are sick of their ascetic lives and wish to rule. The king does not want to lose his kingdom to anyone. He secretly releases the Guru and the disciple. The king and the minister disguise themselves as the criminals and are sent to the executioners. The king has already instructed them about whom to kill first. The king and his minister die, and the Guru and his disciple are safe and free. Well, in this story you will see that justice takes a full circle in the thief's case. The brother of the dead thief runs to the king asking for justice for the death. The owner of the house, the merchant, is summoned. The merchant asks the old bricklayer to be called. The bricklayer blames a dancing girl who passed by with anklets jingling and distracted him while he was working. The dancing girl, an old woman now, blames the goldsmith for making her walk several times that way for her ornaments. The goldsmith blames a rich merchant for being impatient for his jewels. The rich merchant is dead, but his son is called. The son turns out to be the same merchant whose wall killed the thief. Hence, justice comes a full circle. At the end of the story, the king gives some instructions to the executioners. He tells the executioners that the criminals will be sent that night. When the first man comes to them, they should put him to death first. Then the second man must be executed. He insists that no mistake should be made. The king gives these instructions because he believes the Guru. When the Guru tells him that his disciple and he have never found a city like this or a king like him. At the estate of the God of Justice, no criminal has ever been executed. Whoever dies on it first will be reborn as the king. Whoever goes next will be the future minister of this country. Seeing the Guru's keenness to go first, the king becomes thoughtful. He does not want to lose the kingdom to someone else in the next life. So he plans to have the minister and himself executed. So this way you have seen, if the kingdom is of the fools, well, the wise people never try to stay there. And if they stay there, like the disciple, they fall into a problem. This story is very easy to understand. I hope when you go through it, well, easily, you will get the message of the story. With this, I complete the video. Thank you. Thank you very much.